Yeah, it's a fun fact that no one actually sees the story in between. Like, everyone is asking for how did it all start, and they see what they see now, playing for hundreds of thousands of dollars or even millions. Hey guys, I'm Steffen from Team Pokercode, and I'm your new cash game coach. So, what I'm doing right now is just firing up one of my pretty regular sessions. So I got tables open right now, just 2x Zoom 500. This is what is always running, just like a little bread and butter game. I'm open seating the party 1k tables. I'm battling one of the party 1k tables heads up right now against the reg. Doing pretty well so far. And oh, fake misclick, okay. And I got one good table in L5000 on GG Poker, and on the side I have quite some tables open where I'm pretty much just observing to see whether there's good action coming up, and then get one of the seats to play higher stakes, which is, well, right now it's just a random afternoon, which is super smooth, relaxed, and yeah, just chilled for me. Lots of people ask me where actually my journey started, and there's not much special about it. I grew up in the Black Forest in Germany, and like had the most normal life you could expect, going to school, loving sports, all kinds of games, and that's about it. And at some point I found poker, and I still studied, I visited university, and at some point I got more and more into that poker world, living in Brighton for some time, finally moved to Vienna, like the big poker community in Europe, I guess. And now finally ending up, probably new chapter in my life here in Mannheim, Germany, moving together with my girlfriend. Thinking about my hometown, I think I'm pretty much the only one who has anything to do with poker. I remember first older people from my sports clubs hearing about that and telling me to stop doing that and that I shouldn't risk like my normal career that I might be aiming at. So it's a different world. Poker got serious for me, I mean, end of university, I would say. I studied business engineering and focused heavily on game theory at some point, which fascinated me. I was playing for pennies still online, and it was like far away from being more than a hobby. But at some point I thought, like, maybe let's put some more time into that instead of playing random other video games. I wasn't even good in Warcraft 3, let's be honest, right? So yeah, I got more and more into it, and then there were special events to come next. 2014. Someone just wrote me, right? You all know his name. His name is Fedor Holz. He was a kid back then. And he just asked me to join a crew to play poker in Canada in a weird rock star kind of house. And all that, he didn't know me. I didn't know him. And that was all because of he liked some forum posts I did in a German poker community. Yeah, right now we are actually in Mannheim Luisenpark, which is pretty close to my place. And it's one of my favorite places here because it's pretty quiet, and it's something that was open during Corona times. So I enjoy going for a run here, trying to do that at least twice a week, or just going for a walk, chilling, getting some fresh air in. And yeah, actually just enjoying the vibes around. Just, yeah, this was more what I was looking for than all the jet set before, where it's going from airport to airport. And yeah. Yeah, the moment where I knew that poker can be my thing, That was in April 2014, and a story that some of you might already have heard of called Cherry Island. That was a rock star house, I would say, that was on an island in Canada in the Muskoka Lake region, and it was 10 to 15 poker players grinding scoop from there. And yeah, it was Fedor Holz who brought all of us together. Me really just receiving a Skype message, never heard of that guy before, but I was just finishing my bachelor's degree and was like, why not, right? So I went there, and the first moment I met Fedor was when he, wasn't allowed to drive back then, so he was just sitting in the back when he picked me up at the airport with a couple of other guys. You might have heard the names Rainer Kempe or Benjamin Rolle, BenCB789 before, and I didn't know any of those, and they picked me up to go to that fancy house grinding tournaments. I'd never played tournaments before. I was a cash game player, but this was the start of my career, I'd say. Lots of people think I came out of nowhere because people just know you from those live tournaments. I always was, and I will always be, a cash game player by heart. So it was more, yeah, a coincidence that I ended up playing those tournaments. So I didn't come out of nowhere at all. I remember the first 10K I played was Aussie Millions, which was said to be the second softest 10K in the world. And then the first 25K I played was, I think, in March 2016. I was living in Brighton, it was raining all day. I wasn't planning on going anywhere. And then Julian and Rainer just wrote me like, oh, let's join and go to Miami. And I was just like sick of staying in a cool place in February, March. And I was like, okay. And so we went there and I played this some kind of main event and maybe even a 10K, I can't remember, and the satellite for the 25K. And I ended up shipping this one, and so I had to play the 25K, which was never my plan. And from then on, I felt like every step more and more comfortable. And then there was 2016 where I started playing pretty much all of those, and then 2017 even adding the highest stuff that is around. Actually, is my pre-grind routine. Everything, this is a topic lots of people are talking about. Actually, for me, there's nothing special. When I play in the morning, I love to get stuff done before really doing something. So it's actually just getting a coffee and then, yeah, starting the grind pretty much. If it's in the evening, when my girlfriend goes to bed, I will actually have a coffee and then get things started. A lot in those afternoon sessions is actually just about finding good tables to play on. It's not the biggest action of all times. But if you keep your eyes open, you see I have three lobbies on the side open here, and you're ready to play all kinds of games, then there is always something for you, which, well, I'm not jealous of my tournament friends who have to wait until 7 p.m. or 6 p.m. and then start their day. I can plan mine and play the hours I want to play. I mean, there are so many special people, like especially the German community is just very, very, very close. So, and I felt I was friends with pretty much everyone at some point of time. First time meeting Christoph Vogelsang, living together. I lived together with Rainer Kempe and BenCB. I was very good friends with Fedor Holz, visiting each other all the time, talking poker strategy all the time. And Cora Aldemir and Christian Christner, Julian Thomas, there are so many more that I'm forgetting more than half of them. But one moment was a special one. I wouldn't say meeting someone, but it was my first time being in Vegas in 2015, just for vacation. Still, as a cash game player, I wanted to go there 2 weeks to just get the poker vibes that are going on there during WSOP. I played one tournament, and I played 2-5 cash game in Aria. And there at the pizza place, the good old 550, I had someone seated on the table next to me. And that was the freaking legend Ike Haxton. I was too shy to ask for an autograph or something. But the next year I was playing 25Ks with him, so that was pretty decent. The first time I heard of Matthias Eibinger was actually the same way that I got in touch with Fedor Holz. He just wrote me on Skype. He reached out to me and asked stuff like, how does it work in those super high rollers with markup? What would you get for like 100K? What would you do here and there? How do you do it with all the money? And I was like, random Austrian dude who just asked me like as if he was planning to play those, but I know the whole community. Where's the money coming from? What is that about? And I was like, not really thinking about it, still in a friendly way answering all of that and like, yeah, your markup depends on how good you are. Yeah, the money, it's like a big community thing to help out each other. And at some point he was there playing pretty much the next 50K and 100K, and you could see he had the thrill for it. Right? He was like, you could see he will be successful. He was so dedicated to the game every second, like making poker his thing 24/7. Like a little, I wasn't like that at that time, but it was a little flashback, maybe 2 or 3 years. From childhood beginnings, I actually like the green stuff. I mean, I grew up in the Black Forest, which is just such a nice area. And thinking about when everything started with poker, it was about seventh grade with my school friends from back then. Just after a moneymaker boom. I mean, I didn't know about moneymaker back then, but it was the time when the local stores finally sold those chips, and we played for pennies pretty much. Our currency was the kebabs, the yufkas, just earning some food. And I thought about who of them could have made it if he tried the same that I did, and I guess there was nothing special about me, and I guess most of them could have achieved it actually. I don't want to be that guy that says like, yeah, it's not only about money, because it's easy to talk about that when you have it. It's like, sure, before it was about money. And but one thing for sure, it's, if there's one advice that I would have loved to get earlier, it's just that to keep the focus on the love of the game, right? If you do something you love, you will succeed. There's no way around it. And if you see it as like, okay, this is guarding poker, this is the hourly I can achieve, I have to invest my time in that to get this and that, that's the wrong thing. So do it for the love of the game, and then put everything into it if you feel like it. And if not, it's not defeat if you take a step back, right? It's actually a big success for yourself. And this is something that I had to learn myself, and I'm now, yeah, more happy than ever with it, I guess.
And we see an interesting monotone flop.
Cool, Steffen tables top two, and that's it. Ike Haxton out in six.
Steffen's got a better decision.
He's a four.
Don't know, you ask for too much. Maybe
I'm not
a deuce.
A deuce
would be a chop.
Black too. That's
it might be a serve.
Nine on the end, and that's
okay,
it.
That's
incredible, Tom. I was 70. On the champion of the Super High Roller Championship. He won $3,685,000 for taking down this title.
Playing those live high rollers is an awesome lifestyle. It's a fun lifestyle, but not one forever, I feel like. Personally, just it's not my thing to go from casino to casino, only eat in like star restaurants, and yeah, it's just like flying around the world all the time. Like, I'm that little boy from the little village, I still feel like, and this is how I feel inside, and I have my friends there. So at some point I didn't enjoy it anymore and needed to take step backs, and yeah, this is what I did, just chasing the dream I have personally for me, and that brought me back from playing all those tournaments to playing cash games online. And so you see me in the Zoom 500 pool every now and then. I'm still playing higher stakes there as well, but just like all smooth, I don't need that adrenaline like playing for millions every day. At some point you try to realize or you think about stuff more, even especially in the poker community. You talk a lot about what's the sense of life, what do you really want? You have all the freedom, and then this is something to work with. What do you actually want? And I had one moment in time where I really realized that what I'm doing right now is too much of it. And that was being back from the World Series in Vegas, taking a break in Germany, and meeting a friend of mine. And she was like, "Hey Steffen, where's your next vacation going? You could do everything you want." And I was like looking at her like that. This year is my vacation, right now. Right? And it's like when you feel it, that, oh, I have to fly to Vegas in 3 days, and it gives you a bad feeling. Or I was sitting there in January and I have to fly to the Bahamas. It's like, that's not a feeling that is okay. You cannot tell that to anyone. It's just not okay. And if I have the freedom to do anything, pretty much, why should I do that if I don't feel like it, right? If I prefer to stay here, enjoy the European summer, go to my local football club and have fun with the guys.
The high roller world is just so special. So it's, I often have to think back to those times where just like weird stuff happened all the time. I mean, you run into crazy people that you only know from TV. You end up playing poker with the sports stars. Everyone's thinking of those big tournaments that are on TV or streamed or everything. And that's the same for me. Sometimes it's like, okay, that adrenaline that it gives you, that, oh, the special moment. Tomorrow is the freaking big deal. I remember the first Super High Roller Bowl I played. I mean, it was such a special, special event that even some of you might remember that there was at some point a lottery to get into this tournament, right? Not to get it for free, no, to be allowed to pay $300,000 to participate in that one. And I remember the celebration we had when a couple of my friends and myself got picked for that one. That's just so special. But while everyone is talking about those big tournaments, that is, I mean, this is where most people know me from, it was cash game always as well. I mean, I never enjoyed playing cash game live too much because it's just too boring after being Supernova Elite 2 times and playing so many tables at the same time. But there were special moments as well. The first really, really big game I played was in Vegas with blinds of 500 and 1000. And I had to sit down. Actually, we started the game without a VIP. Just, I remember it exactly. It was Ike Haxton, Fedor Holz, Andrew Roble, and True Teller. And yeah, sitting down. Actually, I was still standing, packing my stuff, but gotting dealt the hand. And I got dealt Ace King in the first hand, facing a cold 4-bet from Roble. And like, my pulse must have been, I mean, clearly higher than when I'm running around here. Right, so in the 170s definitely, and I ended up shipping and was like so scared to lose my full stack of 100k, which was like so massive. In the first hand he ended up folding and I had a little jump start there. That felt great, but just thinking of that just kicks my blood pressure up. I don't know, that's like one of the main things that I might miss a little.
Good news, the regular just gave up, so I can really open seat all the tables on party. Always feels like being a little winner when someone just leaves you. And the story in between is never told because it's not special at all. For me personally, it was nothing else but a video game. It's like you have a high score. I mean, it's real money there, but you want to reach the next level, and then the next level, and then another level. I started playing out for $2. Next step was $4. Then there was a big step, because NL8 didn't exist, so it was $10. And the next one, even bigger, well, not really relatively, but $25. And that is step by step, and by doing it that way, well, there's never like that big gap. It's really just you get used to it. And then the same with tournaments. The first 1K tournament you play is a big deal. I still know how nervous I was playing for like big amounts of cash online, but still my first tournament buying in there for 3,300 euros in Vienna, wow, that was real money, right? And then 5,000, 10,000, and then at some point, well, let's talk about the 2018 one drop, $1 million buy-in. I mean, just collecting that money in a way to get to the cashier in cash is freaking crazy, right? Not everyone knows. I mean, I know how much physical dollar fit in my bag that is there, right? It's not a million because it's just too much stuff. Yeah, Terry Allen was just so unique. To recreate something like that, I guess, would be just impossible. And yeah, I don't know how to do it, but if I wanted to do something new and try to be successful there, I would have an idea how to achieve that. And it's mainly about creating that community and thinking about who can help me on my way. I'm not a lonely fighter, and I've never been. So if we think about poker coaching or what you can learn, that's the steps that brings you there. And yeah, I think I enjoy it a lot to just like help people with that and create such a community that is supporting each other and showing a way to success in that way. It feels like I keep talking to you about all the people that I've met and how they influenced my career, how special they've been. But actually, this is just the main message that I'm having. This is the reason why I'm who I am, and this is the reason for my poker career. If I could give myself one piece of advice earlier on, I would say reach out even more aggressively and don't wait for them to come to you. They help you, and well, my community personally was everything for me and made me the person I am today.